The beauty of monitoring and auditing is that you make environmental impact assessment live. Monitoring and auditing goes hand in hand with an adaptive approach to EIA. That's been one of the big weaknesses in environmental assessment, that we have not been learning from projects, actually.
How can we make environmental impact assessment better? This is the main driving question of a series of online interviews I'm doing with some of the world's leading EIA specialists. Today, I have the privilege to talk to John Glasson about this simple but very challenging question. However, I broke down this question into five sub-questions targeting the post-decision stage of EIA, which is also known as the follow-up stage. This stage includes many activities such as auditing, monitoring, and communication, which are all very critical to the social and environmental performance of projects. John Glasson is Professor Emeritus of Planning and Impact Assessment in the School of the Built Environment at Oxford Brookes University. John has published widely on impact assessment. He's the lead author of the book Introduction to Environmental Impact Assessment, which is in its fifth edition and is certainly among the world's best-selling EIA books of all time. I reached John at his office in Oxford, UK. John, thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me today. My first question is, why EIA decision makers tend to accept rather than reject proposed projects?
Possibly one, because the developers realize they've got to go through a process, and so they're being more shrewd, more careful in designing out negative impacts, enhancing the positive impacts. So I think the very process itself is encouraging developers to be more positive, and that gives their projects more chance of getting through. I think, secondly, the whole process of examining environmental statements leads to mitigation measures, and that can make the project more acceptable. Let me give you an example. One of my current jobs is that I'm a planning inspector for the UK Planning Inspectorate. There are about 30 of us, and we examine the big projects, the nuclear power stations, the wind farms, and so on. I examined a big offshore wind farm about a couple of years ago, and one of the big problems with offshore wind farms is the impact on birds and bird strikes. And this project was really problematic in terms of a lot of objection from the ornithological groups, the Royal Society for the British Protection of Birds. And it seemed that the issue was that the blades of the project came within 25 meters of the sea level, and birds tend to forage at about 30 meters above sea level. So they were getting hit by the blades. So there was a very simple mitigation measure. What do you do? You raise the height of the blades. So during the examination of the project, the developer agreed to raise the height of the blades to 35 meters. Everyone was happy then, and the project went through. So mitigation enhancement measures during the process, I think, helps to get projects through, and that's why most projects go through. But they don't all go through. I mean, we've had a big project recently, another big wind farm off the south coast of the UK. It impacted onto a heritage coast, and the impact on tourism was considered so bad that the project was abandoned. So we do get projects abandoned. But I think overall, developers now try to design out the problems. And if they don't design them all out, the examination, the mitigation enhancement measures help them to improve the project.
John, people often have different opinions about what follow-up implies. In your opinion, what should be the main objectives of EIA follow-ups?
There are several objectives, actually. I mean, it's worth going through those four, I think: monitoring, auditing. Monitoring, I mean, the aim is to see that the conditions that have been applied, the mitigation conditions, are being followed through. Another monitoring objective is to make sure you're compliant with legislation, with regulations, with noise levels, air quality levels. Secondly, on auditing, I mean, auditing, I think, is one of the weak links here. Purpose of auditing is to check how accurate the predictions are. I've just been working on the auditing of a nuclear power station in the UK, checking whether the predictions in the environmental statement are being followed through 3 years into the project. And it's an interesting exercise. It relies on monitoring. You need the monitoring information to check whether actual things are happening as planned. The beauty of auditing is that it then helps you for the next project. Actually, you can see what's working well and what's not working well. There's a lot of monitoring going on now, but not much auditing, I don't think. Maybe I'll go back at that. There's some monitoring going on, but not much auditing. I think the third objective of follow-up is so that you can improve the project as it goes along. So you improve the management of the project. If you monitor and you see that things aren't working as planned, then you can do something about it. Fourthly is communication. If you monitor and you make the information available in the local area, then everyone can see what's actually happening. And they can see whether the traffic flows are as predicted, whether the noise is as predicted. It just gives a baseline of information for people to share, as long as it's shared. And that's an issue sometimes, that monitoring information is kept private, which is a problem, I think. So four main reasons for follow-up: monitoring, auditing, management, and communication with all the key stakeholders. And they're all important. And they could all help to make projects better in future. You learn from monitoring. And I think that's been one of the big weaknesses in environmental assessment, that we have not been learning from projects, actually, because no one's been monitoring them.
But what are actually the key barriers to achieving effective EIA follow-ups?
Yeah, I was thinking about this, and my first response was it's not mandatory in many regimes. But in the European Union, it wasn't mandatory until the latest version of the EU directive in 2014, implemented in 2017. So across the European Union, including the UK for the time being, it's now mandatory. So I think that's one reason why it hasn't been in there. But there are many other reasons equally important. A second reason is the cost involved, that governments don't feel they can impose this cost on developers. It's quite expensive, this monitoring, especially if you follow it right through the construction period and into the operation and management period for years, actually. It's an expensive process. I think another reason why developers have not been keen is a lot of developers just do one-off projects. This is the only big project they're going to do. So they aren't bothered about learning from that project because they're not going to do another project. The developers who are most interested in monitoring are the ones who have a whole program of projects. So you're going to build 5 wind farms in the North Sea. So let's check on the first one to see how things have gone. So the one-off projects are not very susceptible to monitoring in many ways. I think another reason, I've just been doing this monitoring study of this big nuclear project, and our findings have been well received, but some of them haven't. I mean, the problem with monitoring is it throws up failures as well as successes, and no one likes failures. So developers don't like to see that some of the things they predicted are not going well, actually. So there's a big PR risk in monitoring. If the monitoring shows that things are not going well, then you'll have the local media chasing you. You'll have the local politicians chasing you. On the other hand, if it shows that things are going well, then you know that's good news. But monitoring is a risk for developers. I mean, I said right at the beginning, it's about legislation as well and making it mandatory. But I think even with legislation, if you don't enforce that legislation, then monitoring is not very effective. So there are a whole package of reasons, some related to legislation, some related to developer attitudes, some related to the nature of projects, really. Is it a one-off project? Is it a program of projects? So,
John, could you please exemplify good cases of EIA follow-ups? I mean, cases that could inspire practice and theory, not only in the UK, but globally?
Yeah, I mean, the ones I know best are obviously the UK, but I'll come back to other countries in a minute. I think in the UK, it is developers who've got a program of projects, and our energy industry is quite good, I think, on this. I mentioned nuclear power twice now, and we've done monitoring studies ourselves at the impact assessment unit at Oxford Brookes. The one I'm particularly proud of is the one we did for Sizewell C nuclear power, Sizewell B, sorry, nuclear power station, long time ago, 20 years ago. And we lived with that project for 8 years while it was being built. And we stayed in the site camp. We interviewed the workers. We found out exactly what was happening. And I think that's still one of the most comprehensive monitoring studies ever done of a major project. That's Sizewell B nuclear power station. The one we've just been working on now at Hinkley Point, the monitoring report will be coming out in January, and it will be publicly available on our website here and on government websites and so on. Have a look at that, because it's an interesting study. It's updated, really, what we did 20 years ago. In the UK, the London Olympic site, the Olympics of 2012, they monitored the construction of that in some detail, because there was an objective of using local labour, local London labour, providing jobs for people from depressed areas. And that worked very well, and they found the evidence for that. We have a current major transport project called Crossrail, which is about a 45-mile overground and underground railway line from the west of London to the east of London. It should be finished now, but it's overrunning by a year or so. But they've done some interesting monitoring as well. And that's a live project, and they're monitoring it now. So that's really a bang up to date transport project in the UK. Overseas, I always mention Hong Kong. Actually, Hong Kong's having a tough time at present. But I've always thought they were pretty advanced in environmental assessment, and they require all major projects have a monitoring program, and they're quite tough on it. Actually, if you're seen to be in breach, you can be fined up to $5 million and go to jail for 2 years. How about that for an incentive to monitor? Actually, monitor accurately. I think Hong Kong's interesting. The Dutch do some interesting monitoring, although it's not always enforced as well as it should be, I think. Also, Western Australia. I spent a lot of my life in Western Australia, and with people like Angus Morrison Saunders and others there who do great work on environmental assessment. They've got lots of major projects there. They're minerals projects, yeah, like your Brazilian minerals projects. And they do some good work on monitoring. But it's not just the developed countries. I mean, some of the developing countries do interesting work. Ghana is an interesting example, actually, of monitoring and auditing.
John, you mentioned earlier in this interview that legislation or lack of mandatory legislation could be a barrier to effective follow-ups. And that's related to my final question today, which is how can we design EIA laws and regulations so that they can drive effective follow-ups?
I mean, firstly, it should include monitoring and auditing, I think. So we're requiring those key stages, not just monitoring. It should relate to the key stages of the project. So I think you need in legislation, it must cover construction and operation. You also need to be comprehensive in terms of what you're monitoring, or comprehensive in terms of key significant impacts. So it's not just the biophysical impacts, it's also the socioeconomic impacts. I feel very strongly about socioeconomic impacts. I feel they've become the weak partner in environmental assessment. I think that's changing now. I think with big projects, the jobs associated with projects, I think you should specify the roles, who's monitoring, who's auditing. So that's required in the system. I mean, the ideal arrangement for monitoring is a joint arrangement between the developer and the community, actually, getting them to work together, if at all possible. But another role is who is actually checking it, who is auditing it. I mentioned Hong Kong. In Hong Kong, they have, what do they call it? An environmental impact checker, someone who's appointed, an independent person to check the monitoring, actually. And I think that's a good idea to have an independent verifier to give credibility to the whole thing. So that's another role. I think what's very important about monitoring and auditing is that it should be publicly available as well. The information should be open. And again, in Hong Kong, I like they have websites for each project, monitoring and auditing. And those websites are online, openly available. People can write in and say, well, I disagree, that isn't going as it should be. In the European Union, we have all kinds of directives. We have a water directive. We have the habitats directive. They're all collecting information themselves. You can use some of their information in the monitoring and auditing of the environmental statement. So avoid duplication as well. I think that's another message I would build into the legislation. Be proportionate, focus on the key significant impacts, avoid duplication of information, but let's get some monitoring and auditing going. One more thing, a lot of people see EIA and the environmental statement as just one point. That's it. You do the EIA and you produce an environmental statement. The beauty of monitoring and auditing is that you make environmental impact assessment live and adaptive. And if you identify major problems, you've got to adapt, and you've got to maybe go back and rework some of the assessment. There is a concern, I think, about doing this by developers, but I've always believed that EIA should be an adaptive process. It's not just a one-off thing, and then you get on with the development. It's if you monitor and audit, you can overcome issues, you can modify the assessment. Monitoring and auditing goes hand in hand with an adaptive approach to EIA. There was a man called Holling a long time ago, 1979, I think.
Which happens to be Canadian.
Yeah, and he said it's an adaptive process. Adaptive EIA is an adaptive planning and management process. And it's taken us a long time to come round to that, I think. And I think one of the problems was we didn't have monitoring and auditing. But monitoring and auditing gives you the information to have an adaptive EIA process.
All right. Thank you so much, John. And for those who are watching us, if you want to know more about John's work and his publications, you should check his profile on Google Scholar or on ResearchGate. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you again in the next interview.